People moving out, people moving in. Why? Because of the color of the skin.
Run, 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 but you sure can't hide.
Well, nobody's interested in learning but the teacher. Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, humiliation, obligation to my nation.
Good morning and welcome to Detroit Wants to Know. Over the past year, we've seen a bunch of new people move into Detroit, and a couple weeks ago, we saw the Iversons at Morgan Waterfront Estates with their two little children. And what goes through my head is, what in the world are these people going to do when they want to educate their children in Detroit? Yes, we have the Cass, we have the Renaissance, we have the Twain School for Scholars, we have Bates, we have Ludington, but what about the rest of it? Today, my guest is Steve Conn, the newly elected president of the Detroit Federation of Teachers, and I'm going to ask him that question. Steve, before I get into that question, Okay. Who are you? Welcome to Detroit Wants to Know, and
Thank you. Thank you for having me. 30 years as a math teacher at Cass Tech High School in Detroit. Union activist from near the very beginning, the elected union steward at Cass Tech for many, many years. Uh-huh. Civil rights activist with By Any Means Necessary.
That's BAM.
BAM.
Okay.
Part of the work where we went to the U.S. Supreme Court in defense of affirmative action programs and integration programs at America's universities. And the March on Washington in April 1st, 2003, one of the highlights of my life, that civil rights march at the Supreme Court on the day of the hearings of the Grutter case on affirmative action at the University of Michigan. And since then, continuing the campaigns for equality and integration through BAM and through my own activity in the Detroit Federation of Teachers as a rising activist within the DFT, and now elected the DFT president.
Okay. I've got a question. You talk about activists. You talk about your days as a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
What was the purpose of getting kids involved in the marches?
Because it's their future. It's their life. And I think young people are a troubling point for a ruling elite of a society that's trying to dampen down expectations and cut things and cut out things that are major fundamental issues and things that have been won, major gains that have been won through past struggle of unions and civil rights leaders and civil rights movement. The young people resist that because they're like, wait, this makes too much sense to have a society based on equality and not rising inequality. So we're determined to fight for our rights as individuals in the future, but the whole society. Youth are always key. I mean, that was adamant for Dr. King, and that was absolutely a principle of his, that the young people marching have to be in the lead. It's their future, and they are the ones who are most tough-minded about where the society needs to go, in a progressive direction, not a regressive direction, as often the power and the elite wants to do it now.
As I paid attention to your career earlier, it always shocked me when kids would be marching with you.
Yeah.
And it actually... It caused people to scratch their heads. They'd never seen that before.
Well, they saw it in Birmingham in 1963.
But we hadn't seen it in recent years.
Well, that's true, and we've been losing in recent years. And I'll tell you, it's one of the most inspiring things you could ever have, to be marching with the young people of Detroit for civil rights and equality. I tell you, it just fills my heart. Anytime we've done it, we've had a march, be it around the affirmative action case and integration at universities, or around stopping the school closings on Woodward, May 1st, 2007, to be able to stand up and march with the young people for what is in fact the future of our nation, that we get back on the path towards civil rights and equality. And to be there with those young people, many of whom my students, but others in other schools, their energy, their excitement, their determination, their brilliance, their creativity and brilliance, it's just, I couldn't be happier than when I'm doing that.
Well, you obviously have a love for students.
Yeah.
Do you live in Detroit?
Yes. Many long years, yes.
That's what I wanted to hear.
Yes.
Steve Conn, when we come back, we want to talk about what's really wrong with the Detroit public schools.
Sure. Long conversation.
That's all right. I got a little extra time because I shaved some off.
Good.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with Steve Conn, the newly elected president of the Detroit Federation of Teachers. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Steve Conn, the newly elected president of the Detroit Federation of Teachers. Mr. Conn, what's wrong with the Detroit public schools?
In a word, segregation and inequality.
Segregation and inequality. I would have expected you to say finance.
Well, that's all tied up with it, but we have an historical problem in America that's maybe most exemplified in metropolitan Detroit, and that's racial segregation and inequality. And it's been growing worse, not better, in the last number of years. And the state takeover and control of the district, which has been pretty solid 14 of the last 16 years, has just meant now really a state sponsorship of increased segregation and inequality. And it is, of course, the mechanism they use to increase that inequality is the financial one, to take control of the budget, supposedly to help the budget of the schools and help it with better financing. But it was pure arrogance on their part, and in fact they've been incredibly destructive. And our deficit, we actually had a surplus in 1999, I think of $114 million surplus when the state first took over, and now it's something in the neighborhood of $600 million in the red. And there's a real problem there, and it's bad financing, it's arrogance on the part of the state, and really it's also a determination on the part of the state to privatize and destroy what is in fact the backbone of our neighborhoods and our community, public education. Historically the most important and successful and popular social reform in the entire 20th century, the last 100 years of America, and they want to destroy it. That says something about their politics, their real political line, and I don't believe the governor is here to help. I think he needs to get out, get us our money back. We need to be reimbursed and of the money, and the deficit that they've accumulated and the debt needs to be canceled.
See, segregation. Any kid can go to any school anywhere in Detroit, test into. How does that equate to segregation?
Metropolitan-wide, and it all goes back, legally, technically, back to Milliken v. Bradley, 1972, where the Supreme Court turned a blind eye by a very narrow vote on the issue of integration, metropolitan-wide integration programs, and said as long as the integration was within district, that's all it really cared about, and that's just absurd. We are one people, we are one society, we are one metropolitan area where the schools, it's one community, and you need to take abreast of that, and the state should be aggressively trying to integrate, not segregate. And we've turned it completely opposite by the Snyder administration and really both political parties.
So DPS should be countywide?
It should be, yeah. I mean, we'd like to move in a coordinated fashion towards a coordinated metropolitan-wide integration program. You could have, for example, the most immediate thing would be to have quality magnet schools in the city that could attract suburban students, and then have programs where, and there are some still left in the United States where the students in the city can go into a suburban school, but as not as a private situation where one district is competing against the other for reduced resources from the state, and it's a bloody mess there, but actually is a coordinated state-sponsored plan of trying to handle integration in a way that'll really integrate and really provide a future for the young people.
So then you're saying an entity like Wayne County RESA?
That would be very helpful. Yes, something
Wayne County
like
RESA would actually be the governing body of all the schools, including
DPS? I think we need elections. I think any governing body needs to be elected. People need their basic civil right to vote and be able to yank out any elected official who's not doing right for the people. So in that respect, Wayne County RESA is not the way to put it. But it can be and needs to be a metropolitan-wide solution. This city versus that town, we're all just cutting our throats, and the banks and the corporations and the politicians in their pocket are just laughing at us. That's got to end. We've got to unite, and we have to fight for equality. It's the fundamental. Everything that's ever worked in American history has been when we have the fight for equality on the front burner. And when we've missed that point, we've been regression and going backwards.
Okay, we're up here. Mm-hmm. Let's take it down. Tell me about the classroom. What's really going on in the classrooms of DPS?
Well, you open up our so-called contract book and you see what they put in there. It says 60 in a class. They can put as many as 60 students in the class. I can take out the book and show you the page.
They can, but are they?
Oh, they're doing 40s and 50s, and we talk about it, and they'll say, well, we could put 60 if we want by this contract. That, just if you want a number, 60 in a class, or if you want 40, 50 in a class, says it all. That one number says it all. It's a failure to educate the young people. It's a failure to give them what they are due. as young Americans, quality schools, equal, second to none. They're due every bit. And you, these things are obvious in the rich, in the classrooms of the rich and wealthy, public or private. But here, suddenly, people scratch their head and set up all sorts of committees and special committees and correspondences and have contractors come in. Come on. What the teachers want, reduce the class size, provide the job security for the teachers, as opposed to the current situation is where you're working basically year to year and you're constantly being interfered with by local administration, or threatened by local administration, meaning the principals. Give the teachers the dignity and the respect they deserve. Give them the resources to teach. Cut the class size. Those are the basic things the teachers want and must have to educate.
Okay. We got to go to break.
Sure.
But I went to Twain School for Scholars earlier this year. I didn't see 45 kids in a class.
Okay.
Okay.
Very good.
We'll be right back with Steve Conn. We're going to figure out how to fix the Detroit public schools without going to a regional solution just yet. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Steve Conn, the newly elected president of the Detroit Federation of Teachers. Mr. Conn, you were talking about the class size.
Huge.
You were talking about that issue, and I beg to differ. In a lot of schools I've toured, I haven't seen over 30 kids in a class, even though I think that's too much.
Mm-hmm.
All right. But how do we fix it? Let's outside the global solution of regionalization of the Detroit public schools.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of that, how do we fix what we have right here, right now?
Okay, well, cancel the debt, reimburse the public schools for the money taken by the state into the hands of the companies. So get us the funds to reduce the class size.
So you're saying cancel the bond debt?
Oh, absolutely. The state has run the district and run it into the ground financially and academically. They need to give us back our money. That's our tax money. It's for the young people of Detroit. They need to. We can use that money to reduce the class size, which is huge. I taught long years at Cass with 40 plus in class, or 39 or 38 students in class. They didn't have books. They need books. Every young person needs to be guaranteed a quality book. At the beginning of the year, the supplies need to be there. The facilities are in a terrible state, even the new buildings. The state has not kept them clean or maintained. That needs to be done. We need art, music, and gym in every classroom. Every young person, it's just so important to the development of the young people that they have a full range of programs. They need to have libraries in the school. We need social workers, psychologists, all the staff, the support staff needs to be there. The teachers need to be able to teach. We need administrators that will help the teachers get their resources and provide the resources for those teachers, and not administrators that are cynical and really bitter and just beating up on the teachers and interfering with their day-to-day teaching by threatening them and in fact piling on paperwork and so forth. The teachers need to be able to teach.
How do we cancel that debt?
Oh, with the stroke
because that's the big enchilada.
Sure.
That bond debt is the big enchilada.
With the stroke of a pen, when it's politically expedient for the governor, and my job is to make it politically expedient for the governor. He's got to do it. We need a movement. Oh, yeah. Me just speaking out ain't going to do it. That's where you build a movement. That's where you get the young people, and that's where you get the entire community.
How will you make it politically expedient for him unless you have some sort of stick?
Yeah.
What is your stick to throw at the governor to make it politically expedient for him?
Civil rights struggle and a union that takes no tactics off the table and is ready to fight. A united people fighting for quality schools.
So you're saying strike?
I'm saying no tactic is off the table. No tactic is off the table. We're mobilizing. We're going to march. It's key to a civil rights struggle to march and march, and no tactic off the table, be it Montgomery, be it Birmingham. The civil rights movement was built on marches and strikes. That's what you need.
But doesn't that hurt the kids?
No, not at all. What's hurting the kid is the warehousing and shutting of schools. We've had the worst school shuttings in the history of the United States here in Detroit. That's helped destroy our neighborhoods and has really hurt this generation of young people. No, we're here to turn that around, and we are going to turn that around.
Well, I'm going to tell you, Governor Snyder
doesn't agree.
He doesn't agree, and
he doesn't have a choice,
and he doesn't blink. Mm. And so that has to be an awfully big stick. I've never seen that guy blink.
Okay.
All right. I mean, as wrong as he may be on some issues, he doesn't blink. And I want to actually see you build a struggle like that.
Great.
You know, and
great.
I want you know, I want to be there watching it.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Because it's got to be something massive. How many teachers do you have?
4,000.
4,000.
Mm-hmm.
So you get 4,000 teachers walking out and students join them. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's a big enough stick to get them to do it.
I think we've got many, many more, but I think the young people and the teachers united is the leadership we need. It's the leadership we need, and we will win. We get that kind of action. No, we're going to be back on the road towards equality and achievement in this city and in this country.
Okay.
Right.
When we come back, mm-hmm. we've got an election coming up in May.
Uh-huh.
All right, and we're going to talk about that
Great.
Real briefly.
Great.
All right?
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with Steve Conn, the newly elected president of the Detroit Federation of Teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Governor Snyder, he's got a stick for you. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest is Steve Conn, the newly elected president of the Detroit Federation of Teachers. Mr. Conn, in May, Governor Snyder, who you're going to hold the stick against,
right.
Has put on the ballot a sales tax increase, mm-hmm. which will fund the roads. But another part of it is that it will provide $300 million to public education. Will you be marshaling the Detroit Federation of Teachers in support of this?
Well, we've got to talk about it, and we'll have to have some discussion within the union. We really do. I mean, just as a first...
It's $300 million. What's there to discuss?
Well, okay, but first of all, the sales tax is such a regressive tax. We have a city of people and young people who have such an issue with poverty, and to be saying, hey, the teachers' union is campaigning for an increase of prices through sales tax, that's not good. It's not good in terms of heaping on more misery of already hard-pressed working-class families. It's not good in terms of how it makes the teachers in the union look, that we are doing the heaping on of the misery, or at least we're part of it. It doesn't really work, sales taxes, because the minute the economy goes into recession, and it's going to go into recession again at some point, we lose all those funds. They're not stable funds. And then at the moment when the schools are needed the most to help against the pain of the recession, the schools are having their budget slammed by decrease in sales tax funds. It's no substitute for taxing the rich. This is the real fundamental tax problem in Michigan. The rich now, the billionaires, the companies get off with paying virtually no tax. They get all the tax write-offs, and the schools and public resources, like the roads, pay mm-hmm. for it. And what you see in the roads is just a good look at the schools. It's the same thing, except for many, many people in Michigan, the roads are just more visible. They don't go to a school as much as they drive on a highway. But that bumpity bump and all the rest, that's in the schools too. And the teachers and students live with that every day. It's the same problem. We essentially bankrupted the country and the state by letting billionaires get away without paying their sales tax, by paying their taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And the corporations rest. It hasn't done good. It hasn't produced jobs. It's produced misery and poverty. And we've got to end it.
Okay. $300 million on the table, regressive tax.
Yeah. And it's an attempt to split and I think I've given my initial opinion about the tax. Uh-huh. We will have discussion about it. But once again, it's a very unstable amount of money. It's no substitute for the real answer of how to provide stable funding. It pits us against the community that we are a part of, and it increases the prices and hardship of a community that has had more than its fair share of hardships. I think those are pretty weighty arguments, but we'll talk. We will. I mean, I'm just going to weigh in very heavy that this is not a good idea for schools.
Okay. Mr.
Conn,
I want to thank you.
Oh, thank you.
It's been refreshing to take you beyond the soundbite.
Yeah,
usually
I've appreciated
they just,
it.
Usually they just have you yelling and screaming or they cut you off, but you're actually pretty intelligent.
And oh, thank you.
And here
thank
we you. Are in this union headquarters.
Uh-huh.
And you're not wearing
no.
anything flashy. It's just
yeah.
simple you.
Okay.
I like it.
Thanks. Thank
All right,
you.
I hope you'll come on again and let me know when the revolution begins.
All right. Great. I will definitely give you a call.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, you heard it from Steve Conn. It's on and popping. Governor Snyder, he says he's going to make it politically expedient for you to erase the debt and get us back on track. We'll be right back. I mean, we'll be back next week. Sorry.